And let's get underway. Well, we're going to take Coolidge first. I do see a surprise in the audience.
I'm just an observer for the evening.
Okay, all right, fine. Okay, so if it was going to take a while, I was going to flip the order back around. Okay. But it's very good that you're here, because I do want you to hear what you have to say. Coolidge Crossing, this is a continuation hearing for Coolidge Crossing. We've got some additional material in between, written remarks from the fire chief. He'd come and spoken with us before. Is our tape on, by the way? Okay, great, thanks, Jim. We have not had any appearances by the developer yet. I think our next, didn't we talk about our next hearing being the, what was the date I suggested? 14th? We had two.
The definite one was...
I'll just drop the record. I think the date we heard everybody was... Thursday, May 18th, I think, was the date that everybody was good for?
Yes.
All right. So I would suggest that we further continue Coolidge Crossing to Thursday, May 18th. And if people are here to speak on Coolidge Crossing, we will hear that. The one commentary I had from town council was, to the extent that nothing happens on Coolidge Crossing and there is no further evidence coming in, we're then required to stop our hearing, close the hearing portion, and start the next clock, which is a 40-day clock to issue our decision. But we can't leave the hearing open indefinitely. So to the extent that anybody has additional information we should know about Coolidge Crossing, if you're not here tonight or not prepared to speak tonight, please be prepared to speak on May 18th, because it's possible that could be the last hearing on Coolidge Crossing. Having said that, is anybody here to speak on Coolidge Crossing tonight? Going once, going twice. Okay, I'd entertain a motion on Coolidge Crossing.
I move that we continue Coolidge Crossing to May 18th.
Second. Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? None? May 18th for Coolidge. All right. That brings up 59 North Main Street. Is there anyone here to speak for 59
yes.
North Main Street?
I'll bet there is.
Please. That'd be great. And Gene, do we have a mic set up that people need to speak? Oh, just okay. So if anyone's speaking, please come up so that the mic can pick you up. This is the first hearing on 59 North Main Street. The materials are all on the town website. Because we're running a few minutes late, I will not do the standard dog and pony show on how our hearings run, but if people have questions on that, we can loop back to them. We do now have on the website, thank you, Jeannie, very good summary materials that people can read as to how the process works, one done by BF and Thomas, and a more recent one done by Mass Housing. Neither of those has the force of law or is definitive, but they're very helpful, and they're in plain English, both of them. Please.
Hey, good evening. My name is Ben Gately. I am a real estate developer. My company, Heritage Properties, is the applicant for 59 North Main Street Village. I think everybody's pretty much aware of where we are right on Main Street. I think it was in February, Mass Housing did grant us our site approval to continue the process here with the town of Sherborn. I guess I'd just like to do a quick overview of the layout of the project, and then I will have my engineer, Peter Bemis, talk to maybe a little more detail on infrastructure, septic system, wells, things like that. This project, as it was approved by Mass Housing, is not age restricted. So it's just a straight market project, of course being a 40B, 25% of the units or three of the 12 will be affordable units. And as you can see, we have 12 freestanding, basically homes. And it's a pretty simple layout. I think it's going to look great from the street once we get further along with some of our detailed designing, landscaping plans, things like that. Of course, as a 40B, we're here to receive our permits. I'm sure this will take a few hearings. And as we get a little further along, my engineer will be turned loose, as he actually has been already, to do some of the more detailed engineering. But as a 40B, my understanding from projects I've done in the past, the plans are pretty much conceptual, schematic plans. And then as we get a little further along and feel that our permits are forthcoming, then we'll have more detailed engineering things that we're going to need for ultimate building permits. My company, Heritage Properties, I've been in business 25 years. I'm located in Sudbury. I've developed and built approximately 300 units, half of which are condominiums. I think I've done about a dozen condominium communities, and the rest have been single-family homes. I've done one actual 40B in the town of Bolton, which is 28 units. I've done multiple condominium projects that have an affordable component to it under, I guess it's called the LIP program, where many towns, just to keep ahead or keep up with the requirements of what the state would like to see for affordable units, which is 10% of the housing stock in the town. Many towns have requirements that when you do a condominium community, that's, or sometimes even a single family subdivision, that's more than a certain number of units. The town wants to see 10% of those be affordable. That way, as they're approving new projects, they're keeping up with the state goal of 10% affordable units. I have just started doing, now that we're starting the hearings here, we have just started doing some a market analysis, and I'm not sure exactly how this affects things, but I am thinking that this may be a 55 and over project. And the reason why is these units are going to be designed, there's 12, it's two bedroom units. I think there's 24 bedrooms, which is, as my engineer can talk about, under Title V, we have enough land area here, which is a 6+ acre site. That gives us enough land area to, under Title V, to have 24 bedrooms. So right now I've got this set up as 12 two-bedroom units, and as I'm sure people would understand, a two-bedroom unit probably appeals more to 55 and over market than it would younger people who might have families with kids in schools. So that's one thing that's coming out of our market analysis so far, is that there seems to be a pretty, let's say, a deeper demand for 55 and over, especially with the way these are designed. On the website, there are some, again, schematic floor plans of the units. We have, I think, three or four different unit styles. But again, they're all two-bedroom, and the bedrooms are upstairs. And our intention is to have the infrastructure in place to have an elevator. Whether somebody wants to finish it off or not, that's their choice. But we will do the construction so that later on, should they want to finish the elevator, maybe as they move in, they feel they don't need it. In that case, on the, in the basement, the first floor or the second floor, that space that would be dedicated for an elevator would be just a closet and can easily be converted later on at a pretty nominal expense. Elevators are, I think probably for about $20,000, you'd be able to finish the elevator if you didn't finish it initially when you moved in. So anyways, there's not too much more I can tell you other than what you see right here. We haven't done any final engineering yet, final landscaping plans, but the idea would be that the streetscape, as you look at this project from North Main Street, I think it's going to be a real, real nice look. We're talking about doing some stone walls and some nice lanterns and really, really dress it up so that it has it fits in very nicely with the architecture, landscaping that you see as you drive along that portion of Main Street. I should tell you my engineer, I believe, is also designing units from Ben Stevens, I think Trask Development. We share the same architect, and the plans that you're probably seeing online, he's done, and I intend to use him for final architecture plans for building permits. One thing we are holding off on, and again, when we get into final detailed engineering, we're talking about possibly making two units here, basically duplex. They would be attached, possibly two on the other side. The old barn that we took down last year, at the same time that we took the house down, that is a wall from the silo that apparently has some many people, when we had a site walk back in, I believe it was December, there were a few people from the town that talked about possibly saving that wall. And if we can, we're going to try to work around that to preserve it. And the way we would do that is to create a little space by joining maybe two of these units together on both sides. But again, it would still be 12 units under Title V. We have enough septic area to support the 24 bedrooms, and how we distribute the units and get to final design. I think that's really all I have is an overview. If you'd like, my engineer might be able to go through a little more detail on.
Sure.
Things.
Let me just ask where we are in the process. The town submitted a detailed letter from the Board of Selectmen and comments from the Planning Department and several others. And Mass Housing directed you to respond to those in their eligibility letter. Will you be presenting any response to these?
Yes, I will.
Okay. Just not the, that's the next layer.
Okay.
Got it. Okay. All right. Other questions?
Yeah, I have some questions. You know, what do you see as a What's your schedule for presenting the information? I mean, right now, there's a lot of requirements listed in the application that I don't see in material. You know, I don't know that your survey, two-foot contours.
It's a long list of things, right?
It didn't seem like it was. And, I mean, there's, you know, the grading, the required setbacks. You made a presentation in your application that there would be four three-bedroom units and eight two-bedroom units. And I just heard you say that there might all be two-bedroom units, so.
Well, yeah.
And then when are you going to make a determination about, you know, what the actual design is?
Well, again, my understanding on a 40B projects is the permits can be obtained with schematic conceptual plans.
No, wait a minute. This is not even schematic. This is just a concept of 12 units on a site. You don't have the number of bedrooms. You don't have any, well, maybe your engineer will present something, but there's no drawings indicating any of the engineering. None of the drainage. I mean, what are you doing for sewerage? There's just not enough information, in my opinion.
But like I said, I'm just giving you a little overview of the project. My engineer can talk to some of those points.
Okay, but my question is, you know, if we open the hearing now, we have, and correct me if I'm wrong, we have 180 days to review. You don't have any of the information to start the review.
Then am I hearing you correctly that what you're saying is I don't need to have a full construction set today? And I think my review of regulations is set, you're right on that. And I'd agree with you, Ron, that these are pretty well short of what the mass housing regulations require and what their letter of eligibility told them to do and what the our various boards asked them to do. It's not the end of the day, but it just means we need to move ahead. The plans don't have to come out of your pocket tonight, but somewhere between here and the end of the hearing, there's going to have to be a whole lot more detail. And it sounds like we're on the same page.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And there are at least some people who would have been glad to see it sooner.
Yes.
Fair.
Well, if you can't answer the question about the schedule of when the information will be provided, I'd say by the next hearing, I would like to know specifically when all these details will be presented.
That's fair.
That's fair.
John, any questions for me?
No.
Not at this time, as you say.
Not at this time.
All right. Maybe you should have, it would be good to have your engineer spin things out a little more. Obviously, the group is prepared and very interested in the case.
Yes.
Okay.
I want to be fair with bad news. I don't know a lot of details, but I'll explain this project to you.
Yeah.
Peter Beavis, engineering design consultant. So I just introduced the existing project we started with here. So we've got a site, 6 acres of land on North Main Street, 1627 would be to my right. To the south, plans going from south to north. Our site is a sloping property, so your highest point would be here to the south. Sheeting to the north, we've got a conrail line to our west, and to our east is North Main Street. Coolidge Street would be to the north. And on our site, again, sloping back this way, our drainage all flows this way, we've got a wetland. Our wetland forms in this section of the site. It was flagged by Ecotec. We had a peer review with the Conservation Commission coming out looking at our wetland line. We have a resource area delineation that has been confirmed for that. We also conducted soil testing for three separate building lots on this site. We have an approval not required plan from the planning board for three separate building lots on this site. Just flip ahead to that sheet. So this is an endorsed plan by the planning board.
Depends on a section 4.4 special permit.
Correct. Special permit.
Yeah, it's a special permit. It's not an A&R plan, but correct. Keep going.
Didn't mean to be, sorry, in the details.
It's a Sherborn unique.
Sherborn unique, correct. And we've also conducted soil testing for three individual lots on this site. We've got sandy gravel soil condition, groundwater will vary depending on your relationship to the wetland resource area on the site. We've got a riverfront area also to our west of Conway and flowing through the site to the north. Again, all the water going to the north from the site. Again, going back to the lots, I have a board of health permit for the three lots. I have an order of conditions for the three lots for work in the buffer zone, for the septic system, for the three individual lots outside of the resource lands for the property. For our proposal, we will have an onsite sewage disposal system that's going to be located in that center portion of the site right here. We will have, for water supply, we'll have two wells on site to provide potable water for our 12 units. For stormwater management, we will have infiltrator drainage here before it reaches North Main Street. And we'll have infiltrator drainage associated with each of our dwelling units. And we'll have additional infiltrator drainage that's going to be located to the north on the site as well. For gas, I believe we will be using propane here. We have natural gas in North Main Street.
And we have natural gas.
Yeah.
We do have natural gas, so we will be using natural gas, which is help us a great deal as far as siting. We have overhead power. Those utility poles are located on our existing conditions plant. So we'll be bringing underground services to the units and then communications infrastructure as well. We'll have some activities that enter the buffer zone, so we will need an order of conditions for this project. I've shown that here. This is the restrictive 30-foot. The 50-foot, we are touching that with one of our decks in the current layout of this building. And the 100-foot buffer zone captures 5 units. Board of Health, again, with most of the soil testing we already have completed, I believe we would have enough to support the design of our leaching area for this development as well. We would obviously have to submit to them and go through a review with the health agent on those details. We've not designed the soil absorption system yet. We've not designed the leaching areas yet for the stormwater management. We basically have this concept plan.
And did you touch on the wells?
They would be on-site wells that would be compliant
where?
With. They'll be on a siting plan with our soil absorption system. But we have a plan on siting two wells to support the number of units that we have.
All right, and then that is sort of the level of detail that you have now.
That's right.
And Mr. Gately, can I ask you a quick question on your 4.4 status? I think if I understand it correctly, your predecessor got a 4.4 permit for the three lots on the plan you showed, and you've got that permit and that plan off record, sort of in your pocket. Use them if you need them.
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah, understood. Do you want to see that again?
Maybe be helpful for just for people to see.
The only thing I don't have is the endorsement on here because I had just
right,
but that's the
right, point. Right. So lots one and two, if my eyes are treating me correctly, are complying lots, and then lot three with the pork chop is the 4.4 lot in the language of our zoning bylaw.
Right. And as part of that, I probably also should point out that we did create two parcels within that. We were trying to accommodate our abutters. At some point through this process, we'd like to continue to try to support our abutters. And when we get a final permit from you, we want to structure it in a manner that allows us to create those parcels. I would probably have to go back to the board and either through 81X eliminate the internal lots and not need the board's endorsement, or I could go and get a board endorsed plan with parcels on it.
Right.
We could do it that way, one or the other.
Right. It really matter at this point. If we can come to closure here, there are a bunch of different ways to get
it done.
Subdivision purposes.
But that was the intent. I want to explain those two parcels, and that is continuing to be part of our program.
And I think I saw Gina back there, and I assume you'd agree that assuming a deal can be made, unwinding the prior 4.4 from an A&R standpoint is relatively easily done.
Yes.
Okay, anything else to tell us about that you have at this point on traffic? Anything like that? Sounds like you haven't really developed that yet.
That's right, yeah, all the comments in the site approval, we plan on addressing immediately.
Right, okay, so we would hope that you would come back next time. And I'm thinking that's probably the 18th as well. Maybe not with all the answers to all of these, but prepared to lay out a fairly concrete timeline as to how you're going to respond to these questions and the plannings and what. But obviously you won't have the plans done by then. Or if you do, we'll be very impressed and surprised.
I don't want to disappoint you, but that's an awful lot to do.
So we'll do our best.
I've been to these rodeos before, and okay, impressed was an understatement.
Thank you.
Other questions from the board members at this point?
Not for me at this point.
No, it's just a little concern I have. I know that on another project in the town, the elevations of the units represented the front elevations, and as it's being built, the most prominent elevations of the units are actually the rear and the side. So I would like to see, you know, detailed elevations of that face the public way, the street. I mean, I did see in your packet, you had front elevation, so I didn't see any from the side views.
For the most part, the current orientation, I don't know if you're still continuing to think like this, but we did have one that was oriented towards North Main, and then the others would be a side view. You can certainly do that.
Yeah.
There's no reason why the architect can't put that together. So.
Sure, please, and maybe the views from the abutters as well, just because that will come up, what they look like.
Absolutely.
And if I recall correctly, one of the letters from, I think, the selectmen not only applauded the front face on the south-facing building, but asked if maybe the northernmost close to the street might be the same, an area, sort of using the buildings to screen the rest of the project. That's what I think.
We could. There were some trees in that area that we
were being applauded for shading the trees, so maybe there's attention there that has to be balanced.
I was going to start with my introduction that those of you who don't know this site, it's kind of hard not to because of the boarded up building that was there for so long and then it disappeared.
That's one way of putting it, but whatever happened, it was not your responsibility.
Okay.
A long and happy history again.
Right. So, I mean, do you intend to develop some more features like maybe visitor parking?
Yes.
And the radius at the far end seems to be fairly tight. Does that meet the fire truck turn radius?
We'll ensure that it does.
It does?
I will ensure that it does. Okay. I don't know whether it does currently. I've not put a turning template on it, but I will ensure that it does.
I won't get into the relationship between you and your client, but is one of your tasks, I hope, to come up with the list of waivers that you'll need, because the application as submitted said, we don't need any waivers, and that's not quite right.
I didn't write it. There's a number in my mind that I would suggest to Mr. Regeely that we need.
Right. There's a number that I would suggest you just grab.
Yes, exactly. I think
you want to go the same way that I am. Put them in the list.
That's right. We'll have it.
It'll make all of our jobs easier.
Getting those early on would be most helpful for you, so you give us some guidance.
Just multifamily on a single family zone site, big one. Do you comply with the setbacks, do you know, on the neighbor sides?
No.
Okay.
All right. We've tried our best to meet every setback that we could, but there are some that we wouldn't need.
Right, okay. We'll just list them out because that makes everybody else's job easier to be able to focus on.
The importance of this layout was really to create this, what we a neighborhood center. That's really what this was about, was to cluster around a center, the way we did our villages yesteryear. That's kind of the concept here, so. We like to try to stick with another project where it's just done this, and we struggle to try to maintain it, be more successful.
Right. Certainly the town comments reflect generalized support for that. And did I see correctly that you need to include into the 50-foot buffer at least?
Yes, that would be another area that I would see a waiver from the local requirements, is activities and resource buffers, but to the extent that we need to do that, we need to be minimizing our activity area and being able to have a designated area that was vastly wider. So we have a narrow footprint where we have an activity, but we can dedicate a wider area with no activities at all. And we had some other historic features in the site that we were trying to maintain. So it might be a little bit different by that too.
That would be great if you could sort of spin that out in a way that doesn't waste the developer's money, but also makes it clear so that people can look at it locally. I think you will find our Conservation Commission alert on these issues. And likewise, the Board of Health quite alert on these issues. Well, that's a good term. Independent is what? But yeah, there is a great sensitivity in the town. So yes, to the extent you can say, we're doing this, here's why we're doing it, here's the trade-offs we made, that will be very helpful, I think, to our boards in that review. Other questions at this point from citizens? Oh.
First of all, to the extent you have provided the architectural plans, I'm happy with the way that houses are designed. They look very attractive. I'm sorry if this is in the material, but is this set up as a condominium?
Yes, it is. It's a condominium.
Right. I don't think it said that, but it was implied. Yeah.
And the pricing of the units seems high to me, and I'm just wondering in terms of the financial viability, what happens if you build some and then they don't sell?
Well, I mean that's the risk of any development. It's not specific to this project. Like I said earlier, I'm in the middle of commissioning a market study, and the preliminary results seem to suggest that 55 and over might be the right market for this. Given the price point, given the design of the units, the two bedrooms. So anyways, we're just...
$1 million for two bedrooms. Seems for this town at least.
Right.
I'm just asking a question because yeah. if
these are very sizable.
It's a condominium, so who's going to be responsible? It isn't fully built out for the maintenance.
Perhaps it would be.
There'll be a homeowners association.
Right. There's a fair amount of sensitivity in the town about this that is not your responsibility or you're doing, but there's a project at the other side of town, Whitney Farms, that you may be familiar with, that is, I think, in everybody's view, very badly missed the mark. And in general, whether they make money selling their condominiums or not is not our issue, or definitely not before this board. But when people come back and say, oh gosh, the units aren't selling, we need to change this, we need to change that, it is this board's business. And I think what Jonathan is trying to telegraph is, to the extent that your project looks robust and economically sustainable, it makes it easier for us to deal with things like reserves and planning for relative to economic disasters. But don't we still have like Whitney Farm from the pipe tank or something like that? No. Mm-hmm. And that was built when? But whatever. Not your fault, but there's, again, a great deal of alertness on the issue.
but I didn't mean to strike a negative tone. I really do like the design that you've started with, and hopefully it'll be executed on all four sides of the structures. So we are seeing the same more, much more detail. Next meeting.
Questions? I plan on having that, like you suggested, elevation, looking at the site from Main Street, looking at it from the body properties, so.
Right.
And.
It'll be a process.
Right.
We're waiting on that. I can now tell everybody that I was the lucky one being stuck on the turnpike because Roger's flight is delayed in DC and he won't be here at all. You think you're doing badly until someone's doing worse. Questions from anybody here who might want to identify themselves as a member of the Conservation Commission, for example?
Michael Lesser, 54 Forest.
Oh, you got to come up here, though.
Michael Lesser, 54 Forest Street, Chair of the Conservation Commission. Simple question of just either for the next meeting, just if you want to at some point offer what the schedule issues will be for filing with the Conservation Commission for a notice of intent, to extend how it's going to fit in with the schedule of what you're filing for here, offer something now or wait for the next meeting. That's something that we'd be looking for, so if the board make reviews, that we do it.
Other questions? Anybody else from that section of Forest Street who wants to be heard? By chance.
Darrell Beardsley, Chair of the Board. So certainly septic plans and well plans are in the future. Are you preparing to do the BHIR, so the Environmental Health?
We'll let the mic work by itself. Just project right. Towards them.
I'm asking whether they're going to do an EHIR, it's an Environmental Health Impact Report. It's a requirement in our regulations for anything other than a single family home or a single lot. So this qualifies. And there are a number of goals, but one of the main goals is to look at what the interaction might be between a large septic system and a well's on site, because the distances are not great. So.
The distances are not
great. Great. Not large.
Right. I would say to the extent that we can, and I mean, Lynn would certainly be welcome to do that. If there's something that we need a waiver on, then we may have to isolate one of the line items. And I just don't want to say how blunt that we can do it, but I think we'll make an attempt to do it, and then we come up with a rational reason maybe why we're not doing a certain portion of it, right, and ask for the applicable waiver.
Okay.
But we'll do our best.
Okay.
Thank you.
You don't have to live in their house to speak, by the way.
Pardon me?
Oh.
Is this open to the general public?
Yes, it really is.
Okay.
Because I know both Michael and Darrell, and they're here at this meeting.
I thought there was some
protocol
here.
No, please.
I'm Lorraine Martinson. I live at 61 North Main Street. That's the house directly to the north.
Here?
Yes, right. We bought our house in 1993. And at the time, we had a well at the front south corner of the house, which was 135 feet deep. In 2001, our well ran dry, and we had to drill a new one. And if you can see on the plan there, on the north side of our house is a septic system, so we couldn't put a well there. We could only put it in that strip of land between the house and the property we're discussing now. So it's located, and we had to get a variance for that. It's located.
Yeah, please show us on the plan.
Right here.
Okay, great, thank you.
We had to go 705 feet deep in order to get enough water to pass the regulation. And my question is, how can you be sure that there's enough water in that parcel to support 12 families living there? Have you done testing? Is there a way to check and see that there's enough water there?
You have to drill a well to respond to that water demand. So there's no
Where are you planning to put those wells? Those two wells you're talking about?
We'll have a plan that shows them. I don't have a plan to describe and see if it shows them.
So my next question is for the board.
Okay.
What is the regulation? How do they determine if there's enough water on that property to support
okay.
the well?
If that's fair, and that's something that I skipped over because I wanted to get going, and so maybe I'll loop back, and hopefully this will answer it, but if it doesn't, then ask the question again, so I'm trying to answer it. Usually this board operates under this zoning bylaw, and we give special permits and variances and Section 6 findings and things like that under this bylaw and Chapter 40A of the general laws. This process tonight is completely different, and we're operating under Chapter 40B, and these regulations here. And when I was saying before that if you go on the town's website, Jeannie has put up some summaries of sort of how these work, they're much more user-friendly. I'd suggest those to you. You can certainly read these, but even for lawyers, they're not especially a pleasant experience. But essentially what they say is, for a 40B project, for a town like Sherborn, we need to have 10% of our housing inventory count as SHI units, subsidized housing inventory. They can't just be affordable. In fact, they have to be available to the right people the right way in a lottery and this, that, and the other thing. For Sherborn, our subsidized housing inventory is 2.3% or 2.4%. And if it were over 10%, we would be able to say we don't have to do these 40B projects. If you're under 10%, your local rules, your non-state rules, are presumed to be a local obstruction that should be swept aside. Mm-hmm. And so what this board is charged with doing under the statute is reviewing the application, hearing from the other boards. We don't replace the Board of Health or the CONSCOM. Essentially, they run their process and report to us, and we take their output. But for other boards, like the Planning Board or some others, we sit in their shoes, and we are charged with either giving the permit or coming up with very good reasons why not, issues of substantial local concern. And the statute gives us a very whether you think it's fair or not is a matter of public policy and not up to us. Very clear set of handcuffs of things we can consider and things we can't consider. So we couldn't turn to Mr. Gatlin and say, well, that's too much of a burden on the school system. Go home. That is the classic example of what the board was not allowed to do.
Water is one of those issues
where we are allowed to.
That's what I'm asking.
Right. And in the case, you may have heard of the Stowe case?
No.
Okay. So, this statute has been on the books 50, 60 years now, and the number of where our decision goes, if the developer is unhappy with it, is to a group called HAC, which has nothing to do with our local politicians. It's the name of the Housing Appeals Committee. And in the 60 years that the statute's been on the books, or 50, the number of HAC rulings in favor of towns with less than 10% affordable housing is, I believe, zero. HAC's rulings then get appealed to the appeals court. At the appeals court level, the town of Stowe, which had raised very serious and concrete concerns about the water quality and interaction with nearby septic systems, that was upheld by the appeals court. There are as many different interpretations of what Stowe really means as there are people who have read it. But certainly, the question you raise of, will there be enough water, and will it be clean enough, is a very legitimate issue for examination, and potentially a grounds for turning down or conditioning. I hope that answered it. Probably more words than you wanted.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Maybe, but yeah. Okay, that's good. And at what point in the process does that come up?
Sure. So it's iterative. They'll probably come back next time and say, here's what we've done about wells so far. Our water engineer thinks there's water here. He's done this hook to hydrogeology. He thinks here and here, and it'll probably be somewhere in the back, would be my guess. Wetlands are, all other things being equal, fabulous places often to locate a well. And so he may say, we've got two fabulous well locations back there that are nowhere near your well, won't interfere with it, and will provide plenty of supply for this place. And as part of the negotiation here and discussion, we're going to suggest peer reviewers. Once we know exactly what the projects will look like, there will be some people working for the town who will be looking at what their water engineer says and said, okay, that makes sense, or it doesn't make sense here and here, and they should do these other things.
And okay, so the town basically has the final say about whether these wells
not
are
really
adequate.
Not really. In a non-40B project, we really do, because we're guided by our local Board of Health rules, which we think are fairly protective. Certainly in the 40B context, the local Board of Health rules, and the engineer was just referring to this, he might say, I don't think I can comply with Rule 6 or whatever it is, and I want a waiver of that. And this board is then obliged under the 40B rules to waive that local concern unless it needs the regional need for affordable housing. And since HAC always concludes that the regional need for affordable housing outweighs everything. Again, that may not be good social policy or safe or fair, but that is often the way they rule. And so what we would need to do is find, what would not work would be for this board to say, well, we're just not sure, it's just not clear enough. Or to say, you're going to have to prove it much better than that. We need to have something, and we had these discussions in the Fields of Sherborn project. You have to have something concrete that you can point to that says, wait a second, this is a risk right here. I'm not trying to evade your questions, I'm sorry. And they're the right questions to be asking.
If there was some question about the availability of water, would the town of Sherborn do its own independent?
Typically not. Typically what peer review is looking at what they provided. But remember, it's in their interest to have the town be comfortable, and they have to pass the state rules in any event. They can't have the DEP's rules waived. And
I was going to say that you can be rest assured. I mean, you know, we surveyed in your well, so we know exactly where it's located. Because I came to your door and told you what we were going to be doing that day. So we do know where your well is. We know where all the abutting wells are, and we will comply with all state requirements. I will try my best to comply with all local requirements. I just can't assure that I can do that until I get my design completed. But we're going to try.
Right. So some of how much their wells and your well and their septic system and your well and your septic system all interact is a little bit to be determined when we know which way the groundwater flows and what will flow where at which rate. And in the records for the Fields of Sherborn, which was down on down by Western Avenue and Route 16, there was a lot of very enthusiastic discussion of that issue between engineers who did not agree, and the town hired its own hydrogeologist who gave a report at the end that's part of the conditions for it. Because often the hydrogeologic, if I'm saying it correct, reality is that unless you dig up everything down 50 feet, you can't know for sure, and you have to make some educated guesses. Is that fair?
Yeah, that's what we're going to do. In your first well, as you described it, it was only 135 feet deep, so it didn't have a lot of recovery capacity as well. So during the period of time in 2001, it may have been a very dry period. So your experience that you lost water supply was because you drained that well and just didn't have time to recover. And then you had no choice but to go put a new well in so you could get back into you.
Yes, but that 700-foot well just barely made the minimum, only because we were allowed to count the water in the...
Inside, right, in the depth of the...
Right.
Right, so we need more than that, and we know that. So that's part of our planning.
Thank you.
Sure.
She reminds me of an issue that was important in the field of Sherborn, which was to the extent that I assume the bedrock underneath all this can go down any material distance.
Yeah, so yeah, no. We,
just like the rest of town.
We will make an estimate, an right. estimation on that.
That's but right. One of the key issues, and if it might be worth your time, Mr. Gately, to have him take a look at the NOBIS report from that project, because they spent a lot of time on which way rock fissures went, which was seen as important. Again, you may come back and say, our geology is completely different, and I'll say, that's why I'm not a geologist.
Let's take a look at it.
Okay, are there questions from people in the audience who haven't spoken yet? And by the way, even if you don't speak tonight, doesn't mean you can't speak other nights. It's not use it or lose it.
Bob Caspi, 32 Hunting Lane. I'm the butter on the other side of the railroad tracks. I have a whole bunch of unrelated questions. Some are fairly stupid. So, first question is...
We were asked all the stupid questions.
I've been studying 40B, and it appears that it is an advantage to the town from the perspective of what's counted in the SHI. If the properties are rentals as opposed to
for sale.
25% for sale as affordable. And I was wondering two things. First, have you done a marketing study on the desirability of over 55 rentals? And obviously over 55 also has an advantage in that it reduces the impact on the school system, so and therefore doesn't likely increase our tax rates, which are already fairly high, as your tax rates will be too. and so if one could do a study of the attractiveness and effective market rates for rentals of over 55 as opposed to sale, then if that existed, then would you do that? And then secondly, if it were highly favorable, would you be willing to, or could a third party be brought in that was interested in managing the property and buying them all from you, and thereby reducing your risk, and maybe some of your profit, but reducing the risk and having to build them all, and offering them on a rental basis?
These are all fair questions. Another thing I should have mentioned before is part of the process, you have to ask the questions through us.
To you?
Yeah, right. Just say you're asking us, and then it'll all work out. Just
I'm asking you.
Very fair questions. Okay.
And that's just the first of several questions.
Okay. Do you want to get them all out and then mail through them, or do you want to try to hand them
question
and
answer? No, better if I get
response. Okay. So before I direct those questions back to Mr. Gately, one of the economics things here that's not necessarily happy for us is the economics of the condominiums are much more favorable for the developer.
I understand.
So, having said that, you heard his question?
Yeah.
Do you have a response?
Well, the quick answer you just gave, yes, I have looked at rental, and it's the economics of it. And it just doesn't work. I mean, it would be a 40B, and yes, I understand that it would be more favorable for the town to be able to count 12 units, and instead of just three, but as the developer, I have to propose something that I think economically makes sense and is feasible, and it just and I have looked at it. Most projects, especially on this scale, just don't work as rentals. Just from a economic standpoint, they just don't. Land is very expensive in this part of the country. and with 12 units, because, you know, I'm not going to be able to get any more than 12 units, especially if they're under Title V, where we have a bedroom restriction, which on this site, I understand, is 24. So, yes, I have looked at it, and believe me, it doesn't look pretty, just from the economics.
So my question to the board is, if Mr. Gately would share the economic analysis with you, it's possible that the town could create a out-of-the-box solution that pulled in the town resources or town benefactors for purposes of offering a quid pro quo, which would be a reduction of risk. Because if the same thing happens here that happened in Whitney Farms, as you said, it's a disaster for everyone. And having been in the real estate market for a while as a potential seller, an unsuccessful potential seller, I know the difficulties in the town of selling property, and I too share your belief that $1 million a unit for a two-bedroom, as big as it might be for over 55, is unrealistic. Nonetheless, so there could be a dynamic here where the analysis points to an opportunity for the rental market. An analysis of the financials points to a clear understanding of what the gap is in terms of the financial benefit and then risks of not being able to complete the project. And the third party may be sponsored by the town, maybe George Fisk could come in and be somehow subsidize the process or find some other way to motivate the developer to participate in the process that produces rentals that helps us on the 40B as a charter.
Sure.
Enough said.
Okay. No. It's a decent question, but this is why they have to get filtered through us. We don't have any legal right to tell him he has to share his economics. If he chooses to, he may, and he could also choose to have discussions outside of this board with people, and that may be a useful area of discussion, or maybe a short period of discussion, I don't know.
Okay.
It's not a crazy thing to ask, so get to the stupid question.
Okay.
Sometimes aren't so bad.
Board of Health has a setback requirement associated with where a well is positioned with respect to a septic, I understand. Does the setback provision change if there are 24 bedrooms as opposed to 4 bedrooms? Does the requirement go from 125 feet to 525 feet or whatever, or is it all the same regardless? Because it doesn't seem rational to me.
I don't believe the state regulation changes, and I'm looking at Daryl as I'm saying this because she knows this answer, and I'm guessing, or probably at least is more likely to know it than I am. I don't believe the state DEP offset changes with respect to. It's just that there's just.
It doesn't, and that's.
Is it 125 feet?
No, state is less.
Okay.
Well, we have 125 to 175, depending on gradient soil conditions.
Right, but it doesn't depend on how big whatever's next door is.
Right, and that is just the way things evolve, that the state set up two categories of septic systems, single-family homes and larger systems,
right.
Which this, in the past, frankly, condo developments would put in a wastewater treatment system and be regulated under DEP, which we have many more regulations associated with the tighter controls, constant monitoring, that sort of thing, for ensuring that the performance was still there.
Also, the developer are much more expensive to do W.
Yes, although viable, which I was thinking might be worth looking at what Boxborough does, which has a series of small condo units that have wastewater treatment plants, because they were done in a different era when people thought if it wasn't single-family home, that's what you automatically went to. So there are examples out there. But in any case, there's the gap in the middle that's now starting to be filled in this manner. And the regulations aren't there. You know, Sherborn regulations have used the state regulations as a springboard, both on the septic side and on the water side. So we do have this new area that poses very different dynamics.
And
it's not a great way to deal with it just yet because it's complex because the variability is so huge of all these projects, so it's also hard to develop regulations. The board's taken a stand on that.
Right. And Bob, there's also a difficult legal issue that's wound in here, which is sometimes somebody puts their well, which requires a 125-foot setback, 10 feet from their property line, which just means they've just intruded into their neighborhood. And sometimes it's compelled because you have nowhere else to put it. And sometimes it's for less noble reasons. And you then get into if the town is saying, Daryl and I are not neighbors, but let's imagine we are. Daryl puts her new well right next to my property line and effectively destroys the only developable part of my lot. Isn't that a taking of my property and shouldn't the town pay for it? So all these things are important.
That's
pretty stupid.
But so far you're thinking. The third question is, it's my understanding from reading Board of Health regulations that if a water supply serves, I think it's over 25 people or something like that, it's considered a public water supply and requires testing and potential remediation if there are problems in the water. Would this be considered a public water supply or is it a private water supply given that it's two wells?
I'll try to answer that. You're absolutely correct that there are different standards for, and I believe it's more than 25 people, more than 60 days a year is the threshold.
25 or more
people, more than 60 days a year. This is a live issue for condominiums all over the state, everywhere they have wells. From a conservative regulatory standpoint, the argument would be, wait a second, this looks like a duck, acts like a duck, has feathers like a duck, and more than 25 people like a duck, that ought to be regulated as a public water supply. From the developer's standpoint, the argument would be, well, wait, we have enough different wells, and they're close enough to enough different buildings, and we're going to structure our condominium documents right so that these will really act like, well, you're not going to have 12 separate little wells. And between those two endpoints lies a lot of tension and discussion and letter writing campaigns to DEP and DEP staring at it choose.
Okay. Just wanted to raise the issue.
It's a very live and fair issue. I'm sure
I just want to add to the record that my well is not close to this property, but I can tell you that we also have two wells, as did the man's on the other side of the street. He was my partner for many years. And water supply in this region is tenuous at best. And I don't know if it extends down to this area, or it sounds like it does. And so the question of whether drawing off the needed water for an additional 12 homes and the impact on other wells, I think, is an issue that needs to somehow be understood. I don't know what the, although I'm an engineer, I'm not a geological engineer.
Right.
Okay. Last point is...
Sorry, just... Oh, sorry. If you haven't heard it loud and clear, how much water is there that's coming from?
I hear you loud and clear.
Great.
And here's my final... and I am the abutter, and Vin and I have spoken about this a little bit, and again, I just want to put it into the record. So I am the abutter. My property is for sale. I would be willing to subdivide my property and so that my house had less land on it that could be sold, and work out a relationship with Vin where he could put his septic on the other side of the railroad tracks. There is high and dry land there. And that the town could take the rest of the land and for purposes of conservation, assuming there was some quid pro quo for me that would help me reduce the price of my house to make it easier to sell. Is that too complicated to understand?
No, this is not at all too complicated to understand. As a professional real estate lawyer, it makes perfect sense to me. But this board can't... We're legally required to deal with the application that's in front of us. If he changes the application, we can certainly look to that. And if you and he and the town have a bunch of other conversations that make everybody happy.
This one is really talking.
It's a wrong thing.
Okay, that's the only reason I said.
All right, no, I'm done.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. Thanks.
Mary Johnson, I'm at 60 North Main Street, which is directly across from you. And just to reiterate the water thing, my well went dry this year, so we put a new one. We covered enough, so I got through the winter. And my neighbors did a few years ago, so, I mean, I think the water thing is very important at this point. And, you know, I'm sure they don't want to get into a situation where there isn't water, so.
Okay.
That's basically.
Thank you.
Just so you know.
Ms. Pierce.
I have a question for you because you're going to explain these things, so.
Yeah, I would send back to homework.
Come over and do that. So, you were talking about how local regulations, if they're an impediment to the project, go out the window. And then state regulations take over. There are no state regulations for private water supply. So how does that play out in your opinion?
Local regulations, I think there are some state regulations on wells, but
they're guidelines.
Guidelines. Well, then they, in theory, let me try to answer it this way, because I think this answer is correct, which is, let's assume that Mr. Gately's engineers come back and say, what we think of the Board of Health regulations on wells are, we hate them all. We think they're all ridiculous. We think they're all purely interposed to obstruct affordable housing, and we think they should all be swept aside, and we want a waiver of all of it. It's not what this gentleman said. But if they did, we'd have to look at what the state regulations were, and then we would be stuck with trying to balance is the fact that we have some regulations and the state has little or none, enough of a pressing local concern to condition or deny the project. And that, of course, is why it's in their interest to try something that works for you, is because it solves that problem, it removes a risk for them, and leads to a better project and makes your board feel better that your legitimate needs have been met. So I think that's the answer. So,
can I make one comment?
Please.
Just back to Mr. Caspi's point. And this is why as a developer I don't always commission the engineer to do final designs. It's because, and in this case, this project is evolving, the final designs are evolving, we don't have all the specifics here tonight, and I could have turned my engineer loose a long time ago, and then all it would take is just a little change in the project and we're back to square one re-engineering. And I think, I know this board feels differently, but I did a 40B in the town of Bolton, and I got through the project, the permit project, portion with schematics completely. That put the onus on me. I was taking a chance that after receiving the permits, I then could come in with full engineering and meet all the requirements I need to get a building permit. And that's the way I did it. And in fact, I had a little bit of a confrontation with the town, and yes, you're right that the developers are undefeated in front of that appeals board. And I don't expect that's going to be the case here, that we're going to go that route at all. But I think the process is set up at a 40B to allow developers, or to encourage developers, I should say, to put forward projects like this without having to come in day one with fully engineered plans, like a subdivision, where a developer is required before anything starts to come in with full engineering. It's a major expense, and if that burden was put on developers of 40B projects, there'd be fewer proposed. That's why I prefer to have a meeting like we are tonight, get some feel for what the town is looking for, and run with it that way.
Right, and we agree. And we encourage you to not throw away money on plans that then just get thrown away. As we said, it's an iterative process, and clearly you know that we're looking for answers to the various questions that were raised, and well short of a fully engineered set of construction plans, you can be responsive to those, and I think that's what we're really looking for.
Well, you know, we need a design that we can react to, and right now it's not saying that's
not going to be coming. I'm just saying that's not here tonight.
Right,
and that's a decision we made. Listening to Mr. Caspi, the wheels were turning, that he has a situation and he is a direct abutter of this project, and he's got a significant portion of land, and has already said that there might be some cooperation between the two of us, and that could change this project in a significant way. Mm-hmm. In fact, one thing I'm thinking of already is that it's possible this could become a rental project. I'd love to do a rental project. In fact, I look at almost every project first as a rental, and fortunately, I don't have to look at it too long, and it just doesn't compare or make sense economically compared to a for sale project. But you change this project, you change the land that we're talking about, including in this project, with an abutter, for instance, and this could change the entire project. So, I mean, if this board, I think, sounds to me like you do like the idea of rental projects, and it's something, given that, you know, what I heard here tonight, that I'd like to even take a second look at.
No, thank you. That's why we appreciate that the plans aren't fully developed, but they'll be developed more, and we'll sort of work through.
Before we leave this stop, though, because he's not a direct abutter, so I want, and I don't mean to correct my client, but he's not a direct, is it right of way between us? It's Conrail.
That was going to be my question. So, do they have a fee or just a surface?
And so, I don't know the actual fee. I do believe it's a fee. Right. So I'm just going to throw that out. If we are taking two distinct properties, my understanding is that we have to be putting forward a permit for a property because it's still a derivative.
But you could change the project description. The reason why I was going to ask the question was, it is an old rail line. It is the old Providence and Boston Railroad. It does go back to about 1850. My guess is it's a fee. I know from when I was trying to do a project crossing in Sherborn, when I was on one of the housing partnerships, we went to Conrail and said, well, how about a surface crossing under railroad? And we'll pay for it. And they said, you don't understand. There's no amount of money in the world you could give us, including $1 billion, that would ever let us cross a grade crossing. It's not there now. The liability for them to go. But maybe you could jack underneath them if you got permission.
Yes. So, but then I still don't have a fee interest. I would have an easement in all likelihood. Although I suppose they could grant me the fee for that strip, but it seems like it's a monumental task.
Well, you can look in the regulations. At least for wastewater treatment plants, sometimes they can be off your lot with the right.
So I happened to look into this for another reason. I asked the gas company whether they could come under the tracks to bring gas. And they said, yeah, there's no problem. And they gave me a price to put it underneath the tracks. And it's the MTA now that manages the rail line.
Right, right. So it might be feasible. Well, that's for you.
Changing the permit, it can evolve. Are we in agreement with that if we were to?
Right. Well, the 40B process allows you to a lot of flexibility to amend your filing, and you are not required to, but often if there's a substantial change in the requirement, you might tell us or move out this deadline or the other, and there's a whole dance there.
Okay, yep, all right. It's good to get that on the table. So. feel better about that. I think between now and the next meeting, we certainly could have vetted this issue.
What I was saying to people here is, we can't require you to change the project. If you come in with a different project, we can certainly react to it. Yes, ma'am.
Did you say that, excuse me, did you say that the 40B regulations were on the town's website?
The actual 40B regulations themselves you can get from the state website. They are at 760.
760.
CMR.
CMR.
56.
56.
And if you go to mass.gov and put that in, you can have your very own set. They are not particularly great reading, but no kidding, no laughing, and I do kid a lot. The summary by Beals and Thomas was I thought, quite good. And the more recent summary put out by the state, I had it here a second ago. Is also quite good. The one put out by Mass Housing Partnership, the one called Guidelines for Zoning Boards, that Jeannie put on today. Like watching Fox or CNN or MSNBC or Breitbart, each of those sources has their own spin on whatever facts you might be reading about. And Mass Housing Partnership, they have their agenda too. And so that's why I say what they have to say is interesting and useful. It's not necessarily gospel. But certainly for someone who's not familiar with the process, trying to get a plain English summary, I would absolutely read the Beals and Thomas one first and the Mass Housing Partnership one second. And if you're extremely masochistic, you can read the CMR regulations. Is that fair?
Thank you.
Anyone else? Yes, the woman in the back. Where do you live? You have to come up here and identify yourself.
You have to recuse yourself now.
Depends what she has to say. Remember, I could have you removed.
All right, go ahead. Peggy Novak, 36 Mason Hill Road. I actually just had a suggestion following up on what Jonathan was saying about the market and the price point, because I've been very concerned about that as well. A project that you might look at and I think is more similar to this one is Abbey Road, which has just been completed and is being marketed now. It's close to downtown. It isn't over 55, but I believe it's all two-bedroom condominium units around a central green, and they're being marketed in about 729 to 759, so a little bit lower price point, but you might have to look at it.
And they're selling, because I'm seeing deeds in the record of deeds. So.
Yeah, some of those were sold before construction was completed.
They're more townhomes. These are detached.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, there are some differences, but there are a lot of similarities.
Yeah, certainly it's not identical, but it's more reminiscent of that.
Yes.
Thank you for your thoughts, Mrs. Novak. Mrs. Pearson.
Okay, so in the spirit of information collection for them and ideas, food for thought, the issue about water supply was brought up earlier, and certainly there's no one who should be more interested in verifying the availability of water than the developer, because that's going to be a lot of water, and folks aren't going to be wanting to pay for homes that don't have sufficient water. So what the board has recommended in other similar circumstances was to do simultaneous pump testing of the wells for an extended period of time, so that if you're testing them one at a time, you don't know if there's some interaction, if they're both drilled into the same fracture or something.
Right.
So you need to run it simultaneously, and it is also certainly a good idea to, while doing that, drop some sort of level monitor in neighboring wells to see what kind of impact might be going on from that, because
there are a lot of properties to the books, so that's a possibility to...
And did your group do that with Abbey Road?
No, because we were learning.
Got it. But I think that's part of the protocol.
They did, oh, I will say that they did simultaneous contesting.
Right, okay.
We did do that, and we requested that they look at neighboring lots, but they did not choose to do that.
Right, again, a good spin on an issue you're already aware of. Thank you. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, I'm Amy Lawler, and I live at 55 North Main Street, which I'm in a butter as well. And I just wanted to point out where my well is. It's about right here in front. And thank you for mentioning that Betty, did you say her name was? Oh, I'm sorry, there.
Yeah.
Oh, sorry, okay. Well, when we bought our property about 4 years ago, that was the one thing that we didn't do was have the wells tested. And about 2 years later, the water started being a little bit less. Sure, then we had two teenagers in the house, but nevertheless, that is one thing that I am concerned about, so all the more reason to have that kind of test. The other thing I wondered, although I just wanted to register my concern about the idea of rental being on that side with, you know, four or five of the 12 units, with the turnover of rentals that, you know, can always be a concern, so... I just wanted to mention that. And then I just wondered about arriving at the 12 units, being in a butter, we maybe had talked to the previous owners who were talking about the three larger units on your other plan behind that one there. So I wondered when that idea had changed or how you arrived at the 12. And is it 25% of units have to be 40B? So what would happen if, say, we wanted 10? How do you divide that by 25?
Well,
or does it have to go down to 8? Or?
Right. Let me try to sort of frame the answer a little bit, which is that, as he mentioned before, the rental units and the 40B units, the affordable units, are essentially uneconomic. They're a drag on the, they need to be subsidized by something else. And so, the state minimum requirement is 25%, and that's why everyone comes in with 25%, because they don't want to do any more. And if we said, gee, wouldn't 80% be better, he would say, that's a lovely idea, Mr. Zoning Board Chairman, but it's not really in my interest, and I'm not going to do that. He might be even more blunt. But that's a lot of what that's about. Maybe you've got a more elaborate answer, but...
Well, I mean, when I purchased the property, I was looking at, in fact, at the time I actually purchased it, we had the three lots approved by the town. And as the chairman pointed out, that was always my, say, fallback position. But also, the previous owner was a developer, had envisioned something like this as a 40B project. I've never had really any contact, much experience with that developer. I understand he just didn't have an appetite for this type of thing. It's just not what he does. I know Peter has worked for him on multiple projects, but the not far off from what you see here was an option that I bought the property with. And having done 40Bs before and many just straight market condominium projects, I just started looking at the economics of both three single family homes versus what you see here. And it was a pretty significant difference just economically. And that's really what drove me to what you see here. But obviously I couldn't do this under the town zoning bylaws without a 40B permit. Because it's just, he's not allowed without, I guess, because he's own and go to town meeting, things like that. But I just looked at it strictly as a 40B, knowing that it, 12 was really the maximum that I saw as being feasible, given the land area, the bedroom restriction, and 12 two-bedroom units was really the best and highest use. And that's the way I proceeded. And knowing that three of them are going to be selling for under $200,000, you know, you need to be in a town where...
You're going to sell for $200,000 less or for $200,000?
No, yeah.
Affordable ones have a very low price, and then they've got a whole lot of deed restrictions on what people can make on selling them so that they stay affordable going forward. But the other units, whether they're selling at 500, 900, 1,000,005, or whatever, support those.
Right.
We're loss leaders, you'd say, in a lot of other businesses.
And how many waivers? You sort of mentioned a few waivers and a few green lines that are dotted covering some of those. So I mentioned
sure.
here lots of
sure.
waivers.
Sure. Under the statute, under the 40B statute, they're supposed to come into us, and the plans just aren't developed enough yet, and that's fine. But ultimately, as part of the process, they're supposed to come and say, okay, here's what we need of your local regulations waived. We want you to waive multifamily on a lot in a single-family residence. We want you to waive the side yard setback here, here, and here. We want you to waive your 50-foot wetlands buffer here, here, and here. Because the way the board is supposed to operate is we're supposed to give specific waivers as opposed to, oh, heck, it's fine. We'll figure out later where the so the people looking at what we're doing, you, hack, anybody else can say, okay, they waived this, they didn't waive that. They had a good reason for this, they didn't have a good reason for that.
Well, we don't have a specific number right now.
We don't have specific numbers now, but that's part of their homework that they're going to do. And as he pointed out, it's sort of this chicken and egg. He doesn't... If he came in with a fully set of engineered plans today, it would be easier for us to do the review, but he might wind up wasting a lot of money. On the other hand, if he never gives us more detailed plans, we'll never be able to take a look at them and figure out what's going on. So,
right. And part of that figuring out, I mentioned that you mentioned some slivers of land for the abutters. Like, we have vaguely heard about that with the former owners. So that's still possibly on the table.
Let me take a shot at an answer
right.
on that, which is we cannot require them to convey land to the abutters. That's one of the no-nos that we can't require. Often developers will telegraph and signal that they have things that, if everything works out, that they might be willing to do with the abutters. I think we're getting that signal pretty loudly, but he's obviously not going to give away pieces of property unless he thinks it's in his interest.
Yeah, I agree completely. In fact, I think the discussions you had with the owner previous to me really reflected on him. You see that sliver of
land? I can kind of, yeah, see something. That's
side, which
okay.
At some point,
it's the same thing you've seen before.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah, that was the one.
It's the sliver of
And at the preliminary, we will be talking about that.
Mrs. Lawler, do I understand correctly that the magic of that sliver to you is that it puts your building into compliance because it gives it a legitimate side yard?
It's more the parking issue.
I don't know your site, but I've understood that there's magic to that sliver beyond what you'd see on this plan.
Yeah, exactly. It just allows a little more, again, the teenagers with that third car and they're needing a little more space to park. So that's what that is. So.
Yeah.
Okay, well, thank you.
You're welcome.
Yes, ma'am.
When you mentioned the elevator, as you know, in this town, we use electricity a lot. And sometimes it stays off for quite a bit. So my concern would be, if you're going to have elderly people stuck in elevators and not able to get up to their bedrooms, I'm going to have to have, where are the generators going to be? You know, have to really think about that, take that into consideration.
No, that's a very good point, and it's something that we actually thought about, and we'll have an option on that always.
The magic of this site, unlike the rest of town, it has gas.
Yeah.
And a gas generator hooked up to a gas line is just a wonderful godsend in an electric power outage, as those of us who have to carry around gas cans know. But you got the gas, God bless you.
And generators have come a long way, too. I've done projects where a generator would be pretty much the size of that desk up front, and now, a generator could be 10 times as powerful and be
half
the size of that. So there are some real good generator options that, for the reasons you suggested about safety and elevator usage and stoppages and power outages, things like that, we certainly will have a generator in the design.
Mrs. Martinson.
Yeah.
Did Martinson go ahead and name it?
Martinson, yes.
Martinson.
I have a couple of questions from another abutter who couldn't be here. She wondered if the electric for this, electric service for this project would be underground.
Yes.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
And the other question that hasn't been answered yet has to do with the time frame for completing the project. Do you plan to build all the units at one time, or will it be like Whitney Farms, where you do one and then?
5 years go by, sorry.
Exactly.
That's, to be determined. Once I get further along here, my bank will dictate in many ways the speed of the construction. Typically, in a project like this, I would put up probably 4 units at once. And I'd have to decide, maybe based on construction logistics on site, where those 4 units that we would build at once would be located. Sometimes it's preferable to start at the rear of the site working forward. And I think in a case like this, just talking here, not to be held to it, but I think the units that are closest to Main Street may be the first to be developed, because that would establish the kind of the street presence,
right?
The street view.
But the land would be cleared and
yes. A lot of the infrastructure would be done.
Necessary trees taken down and so forth.
Yes.
The phasing of the project and what happens when is a very legitimate issue for discussion, but not yet focused. But yes, one of the things that this board gets to put into the conditions, so long as it's reasonable, makes sense, and all the other handcuffs we have on this, is they have to start by accident, they have to finish by accident. Sometimes it's in bites of this, that, and the other, and that's part of the discussion with the developer. Because we all have Whitney Farms in mind, where
right.
They just kept coming saying, oh heck, it's another bad day.
Okay.
He doesn't want that either. We really don't want that. Mrs. Beardsley.
Darrell Beardsley, 54 Forest Street,
still.
Not as Board of Health.
Okay.
Just an aside, since I had to research this a number of times for commercial and industrial clients who needed to bring in supplemental power for special projects, there are certainly great emergency generators are more powerful and more compact now, but you can also evaluate their noise ratings and what kind of insulation they have, and they have charts about what distance, what decibel. So that would be worth looking at for the closeness.
And I'm not a residential elevator expert, but there might be some potential for battery backup for
that's right.
Short term for that operation. Sorry? Do you know the answer?
I was thinking it's Snyder
Marks, sorry. Oh, okay. I'm sorry. I was hoping maybe you knew the technical answer. There are no Snyder Marks ever at 36 Nace Mill Road, so we have no experience there. Other questions from anybody for this evening? You're not as stopped for coming up with others later. In that case, I'd be thrilled to entertain a motion to continue this hearing to May 18th.
I move that we continue this hearing until May 18th.
Second. Extensive debate? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? None. All right, so we're off until May 18th. Please come back. We'd love to know more. Obviously, other people would love to know more.
Just at the time?
8 o'clock.
You will just do the same thing.
8 o'clock. And I don't know if there will be something happening with Village Crossing that night or not.
Exactly.
You've gotten a favor for that this evening. Gentlemen, before we close, we need to pick another date for the other, what we call the 48-5. And wasn't that other date suggested to be the 11th, was it? I thought we both got back.
Yeah, the 11th.
Thank you very much.
All right, so let's leave the Scottish Towers to think. Maybe we had
mine in my bag and I went to a meeting that evening and I didn't make it back in the bag and I wasn't able to get back.
All right, so I'd like to propose a regular zoning board of appeals meeting on May 11th, 8 o'clock here, for those other five items that we need to have, because that area is the Scottish Towers. She lives back. Okay. All right. Second. May 11th. All in favor? Aye. Opposed? None. Do we want to talk about explaining the board tonight? Sound the agenda. We can do it.
Maybe we can start the discussion with finish up when Roger's present.
I just brought it for sure.
I think it would make sense to expand the 45 members.
So I don't want to.
Yeah.